saw at the beginning of your reading for today, Ekman invoked Kant, which seems very antithetical at first analysis, because Kant is most famous for his categorical imperative. What is the categorical imperative? Does anybody know? Anyone with a bit of background in philosophy?
It's a way of validating action.
You don't say. Where did you get that idea from?
It's the idea that any action you take should be able to be used as a universal law.
So that there are ideas that certain actions can not only be universalized but can be used to evaluate morality. So it's an ethical argument, it's not an ethical argument, and it is very unflexible, is the way that it's commonly understood. Different ethics do debate how unflexible it is, but the purpose of argument is a highly unflexible one. So, however, the way that this is set up is that the legislator is your internal morality. What Ekman was ascribing to was taking that categorical imperative and using what was known as the Nazi's categorical imperative. So instead of using that internal legislator, the idea of every man a legislator in terms of internalizing the law and as derivative of morality, instead it was Hitler's word that became the law. Hitler's word that replaced that space within the categorical imperative. So it's not the moral self, but rather Hitler's word in and of itself. This is how he was able to ultimately go against the direct orders from his superiors and still claim that he was, quote, following the law, because Hitler's word was overall the highest order of the law. So it's replacing any other sort of legality or human rights in order to follow the absolute letter of his word. So that's why she really emphasized that he not only obeyed these orders, but they actually obeyed, quote, the law, because it wasn't just what he was directly being told at the time. And at the time, he actually came in conflict with those direct orders from his superiors. So this is specifically seen in the case of Finland, but it can also be seen in more smaller manners throughout his whole career. Now, one of the problems for Ekman's defense, ultimately, was that he did not necessarily directly follow the orders of his superiors. So how can you claim to be just a paper pusher and just following orders and not truly culpable if you were just, quote, doing your duty? So as he constantly reinforced and reiterated, he was not just doing his duty, but that he only obeyed orders, that he obeyed the law. Now, this is where it gets very troubling. Obviously, the whole situation is troubling, but in terms of how the banality of evil is conceptualized. So the way that he talked about these incidents, the genocide, were tallies on a paper. They were just numbers. He even went so far as to describe the deportation of millions as going, quote, like a dream. So because it was all abstracted to these paper numbers, to these numbers, to these very bureaucratic activities, they became absolutely baseless. Of course, as we've talked about throughout this course, that is what fascism does. It creates masses of people, no matter which side you are on. So, as Arendt creates this juxtaposition between, yes, these numbers, but also the actual people, that she ultimately argues that there are no holes on the verbiage, that there is no way to just disappear and drop out of humanity, that ultimately you are. And finally, the last thing I wanted before we get to deportations, I'm seeing a couple of glazed over looks, so I want to do our first discussion exercise. So everyone take out a piece of paper, and I want you all to come down to these first two rows and sit next to one other person that you have not had a substantive conversation with in this class yet, or that you haven't talked with much, because I realize that we're getting to the end of the term, so you're comfortable. But yep, just move down to